So, in this chapter, we will learn about maps and localization. So, to display a map, you have to use Google Maps. And this is not part of Android. It's a project from Google. And you can register to https console.developers.google.com. You have to register in order to be able to display a map. Okay, when you register, you can then have an API key, and this API key will be required in order to be able to display a map inside of your device. So to do that, you just have to define a new resource, which is your API key, and then everything works perfectly. So in Android Studio, you can just build a new project, which is maps activity based, and register and fix the key with your key. So if you have some troubles to display maps, you may consider that you didn't modify the gradle.build file, and so you have to set up some information here. You have to install dependency in order to be able to run such thing on the emulator, and now you can display a map. So let's have a look in details on how Google Maps work. First of all, there is a fragment that displays a map, and the map is asked asynchronously. So to do that, you have to run the method getMapAsync, which asks for, hey, give me the map. And then the map will be ready, and some callback will be called. And the callback will be onMapReady callback. Okay? Now, you can do things on the map once your callback has been triggered. Okay? So, how we can integrate this fragment inside of our activity? Just put this few lines of XML and you can display a map. So on the map, you may want to display some markers. To display a marker, it's quite simple. You have your reference on your Google Map. And to do that, you just create a marker by add marker. And you specify a marker option, which is a set of options you want to specify for your marker. For instance, the position. Here, the position refers to point, which is a local variable saying the longitude and the latitude. Then you can specify a bitmap descriptor for an icon, for instance. Then you can say whether this marker will be draggable, meaning if you can move it, or then if this marker is visible, then you can fix the title and the subtitle. Okay? You can remove a marker by just calling marker.remove. You can grab user events on this marker by setting click listener on this marker, for instance, trigger an activity or an intent or displaying something. You just have to implement on marker click listener, and you have to keep track of all existing markers in order to be able to detect which marker have been selected. And then you can move a marker, okay. And now we can ask for the question, which is, where am I? So there are many ways to do that. The first way to do that is using GPS, or we can use Wi-Fi, or we can use cellular network. So we have to choose which source we want to use to do that. Depends on what kind of localization we want. If we want a precise localization, about 5 meters, we use GPS. If you want a large localization, Wi-Fi may be okay, or cellular network will be okay. Okay? Depending on which kind of source you use, you may be energy consumer or not. Okay, so you have to handle this inside of your application. There are a few frameworks to use localization in Android. The first one is Location Manager, which helps you to manage all of these sources. The second one is Google Play Location API. And this one is a preferred one if you want to have a good compromise. And then you can use something else, but don't care. So first of all, you have to enable the localization inside of your map. So you have to call mymap.setMyLocalizationEnabled to true. This helps you to set up the localization. Then the localization process will require some permissions. The first one is coarse location, and the second one is fine location. So depending on your application, you may want to require the two, one or the other. Coarse grain location, I already told that, is for approximative location, while fine grain is for fine precision location. So if you want to use the Google localization API, it's quite simple. It's enough in most of the case. You can specify the energy policy you want to use. If my battery is low, I want to use that, and so on. And you have some callbacks when the connection failed, and you have some callbacks for all the for the update of the location. So how we can do that? You just have to declare a Google API client, and then you can trigger some build Google API client method, which will instantiate your new Google API, and your listener, here I fix the listener to be this class, and add the API, okay? So now we want to follow the user's move. And so to do that, I have to create a location request. So here I have a small function that build the location request. So we can see that first I build the location request. I set the interval for the request. So here it's every second. I want to have an update. And I set the fastest interval, and then I can set the priority. Okay, here I fix the priority of my request to be high. So this is, for instance, driving. Okay, and then I can specify the priority of my request. And this priority associated to the interval of request will define an energy policy. So for instance, if I say I don't want to consume energy, I can specify the priority to no power. This means that if another application requests from the GPS, I may benefit, but otherwise I will not request access to the internet and GPS to detect where am I. You can specify a priority low power, which means I want to have a precision of around 15 kilometers. You may want to specify the priority to high accuracy, to have an extreme localization by GPS. And finally, the preferred one is a balance between power and accuracy, which means that sometimes I will use Wi-Fi, sometimes I will use GPS, sometimes and so on, in order to save energy while keeping track of my user. So once you have built your request, you can start for location updates. So you create your request, and then you start request location updates with the interval of request you specified. Once you have done that, the callback on location change will be triggered, and then you have to move your marker according to the new position of your user. So maybe you don't want to use API from Google. In this case, it's okay. But you have to use Location Manager. So API from Google is only a new block over this Location Manager block of code. So you can do it. So to do that, you have to start a new location listener and to make what's happened when the status change, when the internet is down, and so on. You have to manipulate all by hand. Okay. And finally, you don't have to forget to register for location updates in order to be informed that your user moved. Okay, so to sum up, the manipulation of maps is easy when you use a Google API. You can virtually move inside of your emulator by using Telnet and then fix the new position of your user. Or if you don't want to use API from Google for the localization, you can use the Localization Manager framework, which is complex to use, but offers the same functionalities than a Google API. So this is it.